Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann. Sometimes it seems as though unconventional oil production, such as shale in North Dakota or the heavy tar sands in Canada, really dominates the industry. But that isn't really the case. If you look at the conventional oil production, the volumes that are coming out from these areas is going to dominate the unconventional. It's maybe not as eye-catching as some of the shale boom going on in the US right now, but taken in its entirety, it's much more significant for the global oil market. $100 plus oil has been the catalyst really for a huge surge in exploration around the world, with a string of really quite high profile successes to review from the last 12 months. Joining me today to look at the hottest of these hotspots are Robert Perkins, London News correspondent. Hi, Robert. Hi. And Stuart Elliott, managing editor for Oil News in Europe. Thanks both for coming. I think the obvious starting place here is Africa. I mean, everywhere I look in Africa, almost every country has had huge success. Well, not huge, but very notable success in the last 12 months. Stuart, which parts of Africa in particular have done well and why?
Yes, and arguably the most successful part of Africa has been Southeast Africa. We've seen huge gas finds offshore Mozambique and offshore Tanzania. So it's not an oil find. Some of the companies working there are optimistic of finding oil, but for now it's gas, which is fine. Offshore Mozambique, I think we're up to about 100 TCF of gas. Tanzania is probably close to 50, but if you consider that for a decent train of LNG, you only need about 5 TCF of gas resources, you can see how big these countries are going to be in terms of LNG exports. Plus, of course, they have a ready-made market to the east across the Indian Ocean. India is very gas hungry. So by the end of this decade, we probably will see a lot of LNG heading from Mozambique and Tanzania, which, you know, are not that developed countries, across to India. Further up the coast, though, you have got some oil. We've seen oil finds in Kenya, which, you know, that's a maiden discovery for them this year. The government is already excited about the idea of building an oil industry in the country. And then in countries you would never have expected to be, you know, oil producers in the future, countries like Ethiopia, Somalia, even with its semi-autonomous regions, Somaliland and Puntland, exploration is going on, and there's a lot of hope that they'll find oil, because it's all part of this rift basin that goes down to Uganda. And Uganda, of course, is where it all started. Tullo Oil, a UK explorer, found oil in Uganda a few years ago. They have now sold part of those assets to big players, Total, the French company, and China's Sinuk. So really, you know, you're seeing a lot of activity in the East, and Tullo Oil is one of the companies that are really pushing forward with that.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, Tullo in particular, if you want to single out any one company that has made a significant impact and opened up new basins in Africa, I think Tullo is one to look at. They're involved in one of the key basin opening finds in Ghana. The Jubilee Field, 2007, originally discovered by US Kosmos Company, but now a big project done by Tullo. Really reappraising their geologists, looking at the seismic work down there in the region. I mean, don't forget, the drilling along the west coast of Africa had been going on for the last 50 years by some quite bigger companies involved as well. But the smaller, more sort of agile companies reappraised the seismic there, and they decided they were going to go for different areas, target different reservoirs. And Tullo really opened up with this large Jubilee find in 2007. That really opened up what then they call the African transform margin, which goes along broadly along the west coast of Africa. So you have really hot spots, Equatorial Guinea, Mauritania, and other areas, you know, looking into those tapping into those similar plays.
Now, the geology is interesting here, because Tullo, at least, are one of the main proponents of this, and they've noted that the geology is, there's a lot in common there between West Africa and South America, is there not? And they've got corresponding acreage positions on both sides of the Atlantic there, and what they hope, they kind of match up, don't they, across the Atlantic?
That's right. That's one of the sort of the fundamentals of the sort of modern exploration drive in Africa and Brazil and South America has really stemmed from these mirror finds. If we go back 150 million years or so, we remember that they were the same continent. They share the same continental similarities below the sea. You have the massive oil finds from Brazil, 2006, the big Tupi, original Tupi find, really sparked off a look at the pre-salt, the much deeper geology that was being drilled in the region.
further to the north? Is there the same thing there between some of the smaller countries in South America? Sort of French Guiana has been quite hot. Is that?
Indeed. And Tullo, a great example. They've taken their knowledge from Ghana, and they've looked across the Atlantic, and they specifically took a position and discovered oil off for French Guiana, and that's another hotspot now, looking to develop and further explore in those areas, matching up the geological basins, with the hope of finding more big finds.
It's interesting how the focus is so much of the global exploration focus here is on sort of Africa and South America. What's happening in the more northern waters, though? There was a time sort of 15 years ago where there's a lot of focus on the northern Atlantic as a real frontier exploration area. Is it not taking off in quite the same way?
Well, the North Sea is interesting. I mean, that's, the original boom in North Sea fields in the 1950s, 1960s, some of the early gas fields and the oil coming on. I mean, and really peaking, I suppose, in the turn of the millennium off the North Sea in for oil production. But what we've seen in the last few years is some really big finds off Norway. Back in 2011, Statoil and Lundin were involved in very big finds in the North Sea, which have really opened people's eyes. And they said, well, maybe it is worth taking a look back at those areas and spending some more money to go over areas which had previously been, had been explored, but maybe the geology has changed or the science has changed behind that. So I think that's something that people are looking at quite closely. Further north, you're getting into the Barents Sea, more in the Arctic Circle. Again, you're moving into areas which were before perhaps off limits due to water depths, climatic conditions, ice, these kind of things, which now solutions are there to get around these problems, and explorers are more capable to go in and look at areas there. We've seen some big finds in the Barents Sea as well. Statoil were very much involved with, and again, that's something that people are looking at, or explorers are looking at to go into future.
On the Russian side, they've already made the big Stockman gas find in the Barents in the Arctic. That's on hold, partly because of what you said, because of the climate and the harsh conditions. But Russia is nonetheless looking to open up its offshore. Some estimates, I mean, it's huge numbers, but some people say that there's as much as 100 billion tons of oil equivalent in the Russian Arctic. So that's 700 billion, nearly a trillion barrels, which is crazy. But the problem is the majority of it is gas. So, you're going to have to be looking at exploration with a view to presumably a big LNG project, which is what Stockman was originally meant to be. But, this is a big area, and we've seen in the last year a number of very high-profile exploration deals signed between Russia's Rosneft, which has kind of become by far the biggest Russian oil producer. It's buying TNK-BP. Everybody wants to be in the Russian offshore. You've got ExxonMobil, Statoil, Total. They're all looking to help explore in the Russian Arctic. It's not going to be easy. It's very deep water. It's very, very cold. Obviously, you've got ice a lot of the year, so there's going to be some challenges, but still.
It's funny, it clearly does sound like a very challenging operating environment up there, difficult and expensive. How much is kind of the drive into areas like this pushed by, do you think, by the new technology that's available to companies? Are they able to do things they couldn't do a generation ago? Or how much is really being pushed by the fact that the oil price, we've got a sustained high price environment, which makes it more economical to go into areas like this, whereas in a low price environment, forget it, it'd be off the cards.
Yeah, I think definitely the oil price, and in fact companies have said as much, is enabling them to develop the new technology, to go to further flung places, to try out, perhaps 10%, 15% possibility of a find areas. Technology has advanced so much in the last few years. You've got so much more available to you in terms of being able to drill in ever deeper water. The rigs are so much more advanced than they used to be, so you can go deeper and deeper and deeper.
As you say, the oil price has really fueled the surge of investment in new technology. I mean, many comparisons are often made between the actual technological complexity of the oil industry with the aerospace industry on that kind of a level. I mean, that they're working with ever-increasing water depths, reservoir pressures, reservoir temperatures, currently with the perceived limit of depth, is 3,000 meters. That could get much deeper. You've got two areas there, the deep water, which is continually being pushed, in terms of depths and pressures. And you've also got the area of pre-salt, which, as we mentioned, is the basis of Brazil's success with its Santos Basin finds. And there you've got very, very, very deep reservoirs, even below, you know, 2,000 meters plus of water. The industry at the moment is trying to tackle those issues. BP, for example, has launched a project to improve technology or support technology that can drill down to water depths where pressures at the mud line around 20,000 psi. You know, these are huge kind of technological barriers that they're trying to industry is confident will be overcome in the future.
But one of the things that's really interesting when you look at frontier exploration, although you've just mentioned BP, is actually the names of the companies involved. Quite often when you look at hotspots, they are small companies. Now, we know them, we follow this industry very closely, but they're not household names. It's not the BPs, Exxons, and Shells. They're much smaller companies who often don't seem to get these projects necessarily even to market, but they're the ones out there taking on the initial risk and doing real wildcat drilling.
Yeah, I mean, you could argue that the industry has always been like that to a certain extent, that you need to take small companies with an appetite for risk and an appetite for a big discovery that are willing to go into perhaps difficult countries with that aren't that stable politically. You look at some of the smaller companies that have done well in recent years. They've gone into these frontier plays in these countries where you need to negotiate with governments, you need to negotiate with the authorities, which is perhaps not what a big company wants to get involved in straight away. So they've had a great deal of success. We've seen some companies do very well with their frontier exploration and then become takeover targets, such as, like Buran Energy. I don't know if you remember them from a few years ago. They were in Turkmenistan, which, a lot of people wouldn't have gone near because it was, and still is in some ways, politically very difficult. And they got bought out by Eni and have done very well from it.
And Rob, quite often it seems to be for the small companies that when they're investing a lot of money in an exploration well, it's an incredibly high-risk game for them.
Certainly, yeah. I mean, it's a game that's getting ever increasingly, more risky in terms of the financial side of things. If you look at the deep water wells now, companies are having to pay in excess of $100 million just to sink one well to test one particular target. You know, if you're looking at a pure play exploration company, that's an incredible, risk exposure. If it doesn't come good, if there's no discovery there, there's only a certain amount of those you can sustain before you go bankrupt, essentially, or you have to sell out to a bigger major. The wells that an interesting case in point is the Falklands Island. Aside from the political risk involved in the disputed territory, there have been a number of wells drilled over the last couple of years. The most notable of which, in 2010, Rock Opera Exploration, been there for a while and found the first commercial oil discovery, a 400 million barrel recoverable find, which is a sizable, for that part of the world, is a sizable resource. The shares rocketed, I think 8 or 10-fold, within a few weeks of the announcement. On the flip side of that, we've seen other explorers in the Falklands this year. Falkland Oil and Gas, who had some very good acreage in different areas in the south, deep acreage in the south and to the east of the Falkland Islands, and they've just ended a drilling campaign where some of their biggest targets, one of the most recent target they were going for, which could have held, which they hope to hold a billion barrels, really came up dry. We saw their share price halve, instantly. So that's how much of an influence it can be for those companies.
Yeah, and another example is poor old Chariot Oil and Gas, who had been bigging up their Namibia play for a long time, and then they have drilled two wells, neither of which have come up with any oil or gas or anything. So they've pretty much seen their share price dive, down to the depths, because this is a make or break drill for a company of that size. Whereas other companies, as Robert said, there's been a few in Kurdistan, in the northern Iraqi region, pretty unexplored, like Gulf Keystone. They've seen their share price go up exponentially since they found their Shaikan field. So companies can either be made or broken by one well, really.
Well, much as we could have spent here sort of 15 minutes talking about shale production, I would love to do that another day with you both perhaps. I really appreciate you both coming in to sort of shine a light on the more conventional side of the industry. I appreciate it's been a bit of a lightning tour around the world, but that's all we've got time for today. Thanks both very much for coming. But that's it from this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse.